Good morning, everyone. Good morning, someone. Hey, it's great to hear y'all. All of you, the millions, maybe I think we have a potential audience of 5 billion, something like that, that could be watching online. We don't know who's all actually watching, but if you're watching online, we are very grateful that you are watching today. We're excited that we've got guests in the house that are actually not guests because they were part of our church before they moved to Atlanta, and we're excited to have Robert and Brittany in the house with us today, and Robert's going to be bringing the word. Also, I've got my great friend Felicia Utsi, who has a ministry called Love is the Answer. She's going to be doing some poetry today. You're going to really enjoy that. But for now, let's stand. Maybe if you're in your living room, you just want to stand, get off the couch, and let's worship the Lord together.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my turn till I met. Break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter. I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven.
Out of the darkness into Oh,
neither is there salvation in any other. For there is none other name given among heaven, among men, under heaven, among men, whereby we must be saved. We come in the strong name of Jesus today. We ask, Lord, that you would heal the sick this morning, God. We pray, Lord, that you would encourage the discouraged today, that you would free those that are bound today, God. We pray your anointing on your word today, God. We ask, Lord God, that you would bless, Lord, this service, God. Help us, Lord, not to leave the same way that we came. We thank you for it in Jesus' name. And everyone said amen. Amen. Look at your neighbor and say, the sun is shining, the temperatures are improving, and the best days are still ahead, all right? Service will be just a little bit different today because we have a guest artist with us today that we're really excited about. Just did a fantastic job in the first service, Felicia Utsi and her son, Dynamic Ray. So we're really glad to have them in the house. Let's go ahead and hear it for them right now. So good to have all of you. We're not going to do video announcements today, so I would just remind you, because of COVID, we're not taking offerings the way that we used to do it. So if you have the Church Center app online, you can give through the Church Center app, or you can give at lifechurchknoxville.com. There's a giving tab there, or if you're in the building, we also have buckets at the end. You can put that in. Felicia, I got to know, I think the first time I saw her was at my friend Cedric's church at a community event, and I saw her and her son, Dynamic Ray, perform, and I just, the Bible says about Jesus, one person, he says he looked at him and he loved him. And when I looked at you, Felicia, I loved you. I just knew I wanted to do some stuff with this person. This summer, when there was a lot of strife that was going on in the United States, Felicia was down in the community spreading the love of Jesus through her ministry there, and I got on board, and I came and did that with them, and we just had some wonderful times of fellowship together. The other day I was on the news. There's been, unfortunately, some gun violence here in Knoxville, and three students of Austin East High School have been murdered since the beginning of the year. It's just absolutely terrible, and so I just put something on Facebook about it, praying and asking God to do something about it. And somehow, I'm not even Facebook friends with them, but people are watching us. The news saw my Facebook post and called me and asked me if I'd make a comment. So I was driving my car, but I pulled my car aside and we did a little Zoom chat, and I was on the news this week. But when they showed the story, sure enough, Felicia's always in the middle of everything, but when they showed the story, there's Felicia, and she's in a circle, and she is praying like you've never heard prayer before. She's calling down heaven, asking for his mercy, and I'm just blessed. And I love the way that we just keep showing up together, amen? How many know that we're better together? We are better together, amen. So Felicia is going to come. And I'll let her introduce what she's getting ready to do. And then we're going to hear a great word today from Pastor Robert Pedler. When they came, they had their first child, as they were members of our church, Ezra. Since then, God has blessed them with Eden. And they just let me know that number three is on the way. Hallelujah. Amen. And I got one more thing to announce. Robert Pedler is one of the newest citizens of the United States. He just became a U.S. citizen from Jamaica, man. But we love having you here. So welcome, Felicia. It's great to have you.
God bless. All right. So the first thing that I like to do whenever I engage my audience is when I say one love, I need you guys to say all right. So I always like for you to, that's my way of saying if you're listening. So just be ready to do that. So last time I did it, I'm gonna test y'all and see if y'all gonna be able to do it. But my name is Felicia Utsi, And I am the artistic director of Divine Urban Expressions Culture, Arts, and Dance. And I write under the name of Sister Felicity Love. I'm a mother of 5 children. 2 of them are right there. And I actually would be known as a cultural organizer. I also do a lot of stuff. I teach dance and a lot of stuff. But most of all, what most would refer to me as a spoken word artist. I don't always think I fit the bill as a spoken word artist, but I, or a poet, I believe I am a poet with words spiritually spoken. And I'm on a mission to move nonsfulness, motivate others to overcome violence through expression. And I'm also on a mission to teach love to children. So I'm moving nonsfulness in love. So that is the point, all the poetry, or as, like I said, the word spiritually spoken. It's all spoken in love. I do want to ask you guys are invited to our monthly Love is the Answer Showcase, which is online. And our next one, it will be in celebration of Black History Month, and it will be this Saturday. And then you can, it's actually the Love is the Answer Community Showcase online. But if you join that, then you will be able to just tune in on all of our showcases. And what I ask everyone to do is help us spread the love. How do you do that? All you have to do is watch and share, because you never know who needs to hear it. So our Love is the Answer broadcast provides an outlet of creative expression for young people. If you are in tune to the culture in on YouTube, not sure if you know, but in most of those cities where you have a large number of kids dying, if you go to YouTube and look at the artists in the city, they're actually carrying guns in the videos, and they're actually rapping about killing. And we do know that the power of life and death is in the tongue. So God has given me the vision to start with love. You stop the cycle of violence by starting with love. So this poem is in the same spirit. As of late, my heart has been disturbed by the messages I read on Facebook, channeling the spirit, the sentiments of Antichrist. As of late, my heart has been disturbed by the messages I read on Facebook, channeling the sentiments of Antichrist spirits, quick to respond in opposition to anyone who give God glory simply by professing their beliefs as Christians. A simple reference to the Bible often leads to a debate, followed by comments that insinuate the Bible and the entire Christian religion is fake. The ones that take the cake are the comments made directly following posts giving God thanks for his grace or for a miracle or something that can't be explained. I mean, I've been reading these posts for years, ever since Facebook appeared, and it hasn't bothered me in the past as much as it has in the present day, with so much division in our homes, churches, and ironically in the United States, with racial profiling and police brutality on top of crime and violence and COVID-19 dominating our news feeds, overshadowing videos of Christians doing their deeds to the least of these while allowing messages of sexual promiscuity to spread rapidly in the minds of our children through music like a virus. All for the love of money. Talk about irony. Why do we expect there to be so much peace when so many unpeaceful things manifest themselves in our children's lives daily, plaguing our communities? Why do we expect God to open up a window and pour down a blessing while denying his presence and ignoring Christ's teachings as we insist on sitting in silence, yelling, stop the violence, ignorant to the revelation? And in order to stop the violence, we must first start with love. See, if we truly pay attention, the Bible leads us to the right places to find intervention, with scriptures dealing with conflict resolution, character development, and anger management, while not forgetting financial wellness when we choose to receive that. Instead of yelling and discrediting the gospel and taking its contents out of context, spreading around like gossip, Maybe we should read it, or better yet, heed it. Instead of spending countless moments debating whether or not Christ was real, why not practice the art of forgiveness the way he did? Why not do our works to the least of these and not just for others to see? And why not walk in love while searching for eternal peace? For those of you interested in responding to this post with Antichrist spirits, I pray you post elsewhere for responding hashtag Jesus' love is ingrained in my spirit as found in the New Testament. In fact, it was Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King and the other civil rights leaders who actually followed the true teachings of Jesus in their quest for freedom. They didn't just pray and wait for change to come. They prayed, worked in diligence, fought with vigilance and love, that is, all while looking up. And don't be deceived. Believing the name of Jesus has brought us a mighty long way, kept us from sweating in fear and retaliating hate. The problem is not in blacks believing in Christ. The problem is us in the U.S. not knowing who we are while taking for granted the problem we've been granted, the power we've been granted to overcome. So when the power of love outweighs the love of power, the world with no peace, to God be the glory, Jesus is love. Please help me welcome Dynamic Ray. Thank you.
Let's hear it for him one more time. That was so good. So good. You know, and when the worship team was playing, I thought, man, in my mind, I can play like Pete, that guitar. And then when I saw Dynamic Ray, I said, in my mind, I can dance like that. But it's all in my mind. It's all in my mind. But, you know, you taught us to say that. So you know, this is a predominantly white audience, and we gotta work on how to say this. But she said, "One love," and we're to respond.
Aight.
Yeah, it's not all right. It's aight. All right, it's aight. That's the trick. All right. So one love.
Aight.
One love.
Aight.
All right. If you can't preach after that, Robert, you can't preach. But anyway, so it's really good to have Robert, our friend, and Brittany in the house with us today. We just love their family so much. They left us to go to Atlanta. We have only forgiven them because he went to be with his father. He is pastoring with his father down there and just doing a wonderful job. But we have kept that friendship strong, and this is always home to them. So welcome, Robert and Brittany Pedler.
Morning, everybody.
Morning.
Oh, there you go. Thank you. It's Just want to say hi to all the familiar faces that weren't in the first service. And I'm pretty excited about the second service. I hear this is the service where all the sanctified folks come to. So that's a joke. Don't laugh. No. So God has been really good to us. And as Phil said, you know, this place is home for us. You know, we've stood here on this very stage, you know, playing keyboard, playing the drums, preaching, all kinds of different things, serving in kids ministry. And, you know, the love, you can still feel it radiating through this, you know, place. And, you know, I can tell that God is here and he has not left. And so we are grateful for that. Aren't you grateful for God that he's always with us? Amen. 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 As I continue the sermon series that we're in, Uncomfortable Conversations, Phil had reached out to me to, you know, be a part of this. And, you know, I always tell him, like, any opportunity to come down here and preach, I'm going to take it. It gives me a chance to come and see everybody again, but also, you know, to preach here. And it's there's always been a pleasure for me. Before I get into the sermon, whenever he asked me to preach on Uncomfortable Conversations, immediately my mind kind of went to, you know, what conversations have I had in the past or, you know, recently or at any time in my life that I felt like a sense of discomfort or, you know, uncomfortability. And immediately my mind went back to my junior year in college, probably about 2008 time frame, when I was at the University of Michigan in Ann Arbor. I was fresh off the island, as you heard him say. You know, I just became a U.S. citizen. I came from Jamaica, and a big change, as you can imagine. It was, you know, sunny, 78, 80. Then I moved, and then it was about 60s, and then it got to about 13. So, yeah, you can imagine, you know, how I was thriving. As a matter of fact, when I got off the plane, I was there, and they said, "Are you ready for the winter time?" And I was like, "Yeah, I'm ready." And it's like, "What do you got?" I was like, "Well, I got this this hoodie from Old Navy." They're like, "Yeah, okay." They're like, "You need a coat. You need a coat from here." And so, you know, I quickly learned, yes, I did need a coat, and a hoodie was not going to make it. But my junior year, I was in a sociology class, and the professor had asked us to pair up and, you know, do a presentation on the background and, you know, the life of our partner. We were paired in twos. You know, you were with a person that wasn't from the same state or from the same area as yourself. And so I was paired up with this guy. He was from Northern Michigan. And, you know, I went first. I brought my laptop and everything. You know, I was like, you know, I'm going to record everything because I want to get every bit of information about this guy and, you know, about myself as well so I can reflect on it and do the presentation. And, you know, I go, I was like, yeah, you know, tell him about my family, tell him about our traditions, you know, tell him about Jamaica a little bit and, you know, all that I grew up on. And, you know, I was done with my story. I'm just kind of like, all right, ready to hear this guy's story. Want to, you know, learn about his family traditions and all of that. And I kid you not, this guy starts out his story by saying, straight face, my whole family is racist. Just like the air is dead in here right now, that's exactly how it was. And we were in the stacks of the Michigan Library. If you know anything about stacks, you know there are a lot of books and not a lot of people. So the first thing I was thinking about is, you know, what my escape plan is going to be in case something goes down. Because you start out with a statement like that, you know, I'm thinking like, I don't know what's going to happen here. And so, like, he starts out with this statement, you know, my whole family is racist. And he goes further by saying, like, you know, they're so racist that if a black guy even rides a bike down our street, if he drives a car down our street, he doesn't have to do anything. They're calling the cops. Like, okay. And then he says, even in the schools, if a black kid tries to enroll, they do everything to get them out. That if a black person tries to buy property or a house in our neighborhood, they are not allowed to. Because the community has made a pact that we don't want any black people here. I mean, I'm fresh from the island. So, you know, I mean, I've only heard a lot about racism. I've never like really experienced anything like that. And, you know, here it was, boom, he didn't ease me into it. He didn't say like, yeah, you know, hi, my name is Tom or something like that. You know, I like apples and peanut butter. And then he kind of just eased me in and, oh yeah, by the way, you know, my family is racist. No, he just kind of went right for the rip. But I appreciated him telling me that because of the follow-up. So he goes and he tells me, you know, this story about his family and how he was raised. And then he says, you know, but since I've been here on campus, since I've been walking in the dorms and I've been interacting with black people, I realized that they're not so bad. And I'm like, yeah, I guess we're not too bad, you know. And so, you know, he said, not only did I realize that they're not too bad, but I've kind of moved away from, you know, what I've been brought up on. I've changed my opinion, even though this was a core belief of mine. And I really appreciated that because it showed that, you know, he took initiative to challenge his very belief and, you know, something that was so deeply rooted in him. So I appreciated him doing that and mentioning that. Michael Shermer, a well-published science writer and historian of science, had an article on the psychology of how we form beliefs. He said this. He said, we form our beliefs first, then look for evidence in support of them afterwards. So we have an idea, and we come to a belief, a place where we believe something to be true, then we find everything that we can to prove what we already believe. And he continues by saying, as a belief engine, the brain is always seeking to find meaning in the information that pours into it. Once it has been constructed, once a belief has been constructed, it rationalizes it with explanations. The brain thus becomes invested in the beliefs and reinforces them by looking for supporting evidence while, watch this now, blinding itself to anything contrary to what they have already believing. So I formed my belief, and this is the way how I do things, and anything contrary to that, whether this thing be true or not, I'm going to blind myself to it and just reject it as false. And he said that's how oftentimes our belief systems work and how our brain works. And, you know, when I was reading this and as I discovered this by Mike Shermer, I thought about the current state of our country, the current sociological climate in our country and how we relate to each other. We have certain belief systems that we hold dear to us and we hold such a firm grip that many of us are unwilling to part with them because it's what we've known, it's what we've done, it's what we grew up on, it's what mama believed, it's what papa believed, it's what we've believed for multiple generations, and frankly, it's what defines us and what we find our identity in. Even at times, I find that Christians are unwilling to part with beliefs that influence behaviors that are detrimental to our calling in God. That we are so ingrained in whatever it is that we're ingrained in, that even when the word of God challenges that belief system, we don't want to move away from that because it's comfortable. So we want to stay in that place. I'd like to turn our attention to our text this morning. Mark chapter 10, verse 17 to 31 is the text that we'll consider as we talk about this topic of uncomfortable conversations. We find ourselves in Mark chapter 10 where Jesus was going about doing many miracles, and as he was going out, the verse says in verse 17, and as he was setting out on his journey, a man ran up and knelt before him and asked him, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus said to him, why do you call me good? No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. Do not murder. Do not commit adultery. Do not steal. Do not bear false witness. Do not defraud. Honor your father and mother. And he said to him, teacher, all these I have kept from my youth. And Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said to him, you lack one thing. Go sell all that you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come follow me. Disheartened by the saying, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. One thing that I realized as I read the scripture, the first part, he says to Jesus, he says, "What shall I do? What shall I do that I may inherit eternal life?" The focus of this man's question is, "What shall I do?" He thought eternal life was a matter of earning and deserving. That he thought that just like maybe his possessions would get him into certain circles and get him certain things, that he could probably buy his way into heaven. So what must I do? I have all these great possessions. And the Bible says that he came kneeling before God as he was walking, before Jesus as he was walking out. And I thought to myself that it's a bit ironic that in kneeling before Jesus, that he was in the very posture that he needed to be that would lead him to this eternal life. That he was bowing before the Savior who would show him and who would lead him to eternal life. But while he was in the presence of God, he didn't realize that he couldn't do it himself. So he says, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" He didn't want Jesus to be his Savior. He wanted Jesus to show him the way to be his own Savior. And oftentimes we find ourselves in the correct posture, but not the correct mindset. And let me unpack that for you for a second. Oftentimes we find ourselves doing the things of God, finding ourselves serving in church, and many people have gone to church all their lives, but the word of God has not penetrated their hearts and their minds so much so that he has changed their belief system. That they have come to Jesus just as they are and remain just as they are. But the difference here is that Jesus was showing the rich man a different way. Yes, you have great possessions, and yes, you have inherited a lot on this earth. But if you want eternal life, there's something else that you are supposed to do. There's something that you are lacking. I've kept the law from my youth. I know the law. I've had great success, but yet Jesus is saying that you still lack something. When we place ourselves in a position where we start asking God to take control and asking Jesus to take the wheel, we're going to have some uncomfortable situations and uncomfortable conversations with him, because he's going to tell you that you are lacking something, that you believe that this is the way that you're supposed to go about doing this thing, but there's another way that you can't see that's going to lead to this eternal life. And so this is what this guy was confronted with here. Found himself before Jesus having this uncomfortable conversation in the midst of other people who are witnessing this. And he didn't really know who he was, because all along he was going about thinking, you know, I'm the rich young ruler and I have all these great possessions, and you know, people probably identified him as such. Why we don't know his name, but we know him as a rich young ruler. And he's going about doing his thing, but not until he encounters Jesus that Jesus was showing him another way. And I'm here to posit today that until we encounter Jesus, we really don't know who we are. Because it's him that has created us, the Bible says, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. So we can't really know who we are until we find Jesus. When we find Jesus, we find the essence of life itself. Then our spiritual posture becomes, "Not my will, but thy will be done." Amen. Not my belief, but what your word has to say to me, that's going to shape how I should believe and how I should think. "In all my ways, I will acknowledge him and he will direct my path." I got to tell you, I've been pretty heartbroken with the state of the church in these past couple of months, especially during the election season. There's been a lot of name calling across the aisle, lots of demonizing each other. Kind of felt like people were just kind of rolling with their belief systems and their preferences and not seeking the heart of God. We find that people are talking about black churches and white churches and all kinds of different churches, and everyone is speaking their mind. And as our the bumper series for this series says, you know, 11 o'clock is still the most segregated hour of the week. And a lot of people are saying a lot, but a lot of people aren't really saying anything because we aren't really talking to each other. We aren't having those conversations, those tough conversations that's going to lead us to a place where things will get better. But we have to change, because the country's problems will not be solved, I'm here to tell you, by voting them away. This country's problems will not be solved by putting the right person in office. Because here it is, saints, that we are putting someone in a place where God should be. We are expecting a man or a woman to do what only God can do. And so it's about time where the church needs to put God back in the place where he needs to be so that he can do what he needs to do so that we can see the change that we need to see. Somebody say amen. 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 I really feel that this morning. I really feel that. We have a deep-rooted problem, and our problem is sin. Sin is rampant in the land, and I learned this while I was studying for my citizenship exam. Since George Washington, the father of this country. I feel like you can ask me a lot of historical questions I'll be able to answer. I'm a true American. I don't care what anybody say. Praise God. But we've had this problem ever since the days of George Washington. And, you know, a lot of it is under the guise of nationalism and even sometimes more straightforward under the umbrella of pride. Everyone wants to take pride in their stance and their belief and their roots and their culture and their preferences. And sometimes these things are loudest in the church. You can listen to many sermons in this day and day and age as an unbeliever and leave not knowing anything about Jesus or even knowing who he is. We go to churches, some churches, because I know the word of God is preached here. And we hear a lot of sermons about people's beliefs and preferences, and they'll sprinkle a little bit of Jesus on the side, like, oh yeah, Jesus too. And we keep hearing these echoes of different things that we hear during the week on platforms like CNN and Fox News and Newsmax and MSNBC and BBC and newspapers and internet blogs, and we keep echoing these things in our pulpits when we should be echoing the voice of God and telling people that there is a better way than this, that things will not always be this way, but there's a God who is able to change what we see things looking like right now. Amen. Amen. And so we need to be echoing the voice of God. In the text here, Jesus is trying to help this guy get a grasp of what really is important, just like he wants the church to know what is really important. He's continuing the conversation. Obviously, it's an uncomfortable conversation, and, you know, other people are around and they're tuning in. And Jesus, you know, says to him, you lack one thing. He's calling him out here. You lack one thing. Go sell that what you have and give it to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. The Bible says that he was disheartened. Here's my first point. The things that hurt the most, if we had to let them go, is what our hearts are tied to and where our affection is set. And the question we got to ask ourselves is, where is my affection set? The Bible tells us that this man's heart was so tied to his riches that when Jesus told him to let it go, that he was disheartened. And for us, we might not have riches, but it could be a hobby, it could be a tradition, it could be a practice, it could be a lifestyle, it could be a group that we're associated with, it could be a part of our culture that we deem as important, that our hearts are tied to, that we can't let go of. But God is asking us to come up higher to a place where we really find out what is important. Colossians chapter 3, verse 1 to 4, the Bible says, if then you who have been raised with Christ, Seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things on the earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. That's what we're living for. Second point, the crux of our calling as believers in Christ is a daily devotion to God, the things of God, and the people that God has called us to serve. If we walk through this life with only a mirror in our hands, then the only thing that we're going to see and the only thing that we're going to be focused on is ourselves. And we can't see anything beyond that. Mark chapter 8, verse 34 to 35. And I'll ask the worship team to come back. The Bible says, "And calling the crowd to him with his disciples, he said to them, 'If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul?'" Here's the third point. The condition of our souls is what ultimately matters. The condition of our souls. Mark 8, 36, "For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his own soul?" I was at Pastor Phil's house, and we were watching something on Amazon Prime. The best way I could describe it is it's hip-hop Jesus. That's the best way I could describe it. It's a story of Jesus, like, told in, like, hip-hop form. And I thought it was very creative, and I really liked it. But out of all the things that we were watching, the one thing that really resonated with me and stood out to me was when the disciple came to Jesus, who was a black man in this program. He asked him, you know, What do you want from us, Jesus? What do you want from us? You've called us here, the disciples. What do you want from us? And Jesus answers with a simple word. Jesus says, "Everything." And then he follows up with a question to Jesus, and he says, "All right, you know, if we give you everything, then, you know, what's in it for us? What do we get?" And Jesus follows up. He already watched Hip Hop Jesus. But you're right. What do we get if we give up everything? We get everything. Because Jesus says that once you give up everything, you will inherit eternal life if you give up everything for him. And eternal life for us is everything. It's everything. When we give up everything for Jesus, our reward is everything in eternal life. Will you stand with me today? God has sent his son Jesus to a world that was doomed, lost, in need of a savior. And I've heard some theologians put it like this, that God bankrupted heaven and sent him here on earth. So he pulled everything from his bank account in heaven and sent it here to earth for us. So he gave us everything. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever you are, wherever you're from, what culture, what race, nationality, doesn't matter, that whosoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting or eternal life. We'll have everything. Let's go to God in prayer this morning. Father, we thank you. Thank you, oh God, for your sacrifice. We thank you for your love. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your mercies. Thank you for the fact that we are here in the land of the living, God, and you have given us this opportunity today. Father, I pray, oh God, that for those who don't know who you are, who don't have a relationship with you, God, and know who you are, I pray, oh God, that you will just touch them today. I pray, oh God, that you will just touch your heart, oh God, so that they might receive you. And we pray, oh God, that you will just show them, oh God, Just like you showed the rich young ruler the path, Lord God, and the way to eternal life. That is you. We thank you, O God, for all that you have done for us. Go before us now as we give you the glory, the honor, and the praise. In Jesus' name, and everybody said,
amen. Amen. Can we thank the Lord for that word that Robert gave? We're getting a bonus they didn't get in the first service. Do you want to stand up?
Yeah, you can.
All right, just stay standing. He's going to teach us a song. And I miss this. We used to sing together a lot, but teach us this song, Robert.
Thank you. It's a simple song. I'll sing the verse.
Thank you, Lord. We're going to let you be seated for just a few more moments. I'm going to invite Felicia back up, and she has another poem that she's going to do before we leave. There you are. Let's welcome once again Felicia.
Thank you so much. I just want to say thank you, Pastor, for your love. I know he mentioned the basket drop, but I remember from that, he answered my call when I was searching for people in the community, pastors, faith leaders, to come to our, I think it was the Day of Reconciliation, and it was actually in response to, it was in September, and it was a response to the police brutality and the excessive force then. So I'm saying all that because we had, our summer of that happening, but basically it has, all this stuff has been going around and around, and until, I believe God's people have a ear to hear, and more, I believe, until God's people that who have been called according to his purpose, when they heed their calling and get up and walk in faith without, wondering what they're going to get out of it. That's when things will change. And I thank the pastor of this church for being one of those movers, and his son that I've seen in the community. All the time I saw Noah in the community, I didn't know that they were sons and father. So I'm blessed to see God's people in the community, outside of the walls, doing what I know that we're supposed to do as Christians. So thank you for that. Okay, so this last series of poems, I'm going to go ahead and share those. And I already told you what I do, but I will tell you that after this first poem, I'm going to have you all join in with me. So now that Pastor Philip knows what to do, you can follow him. All right. So one love. All right. Good job. All right. All right, and this one is called Free Indeed. Look at me. You can't contain me. I wasn't born a slave, and I ain't gonna be. There's a thin line between love and complacency. Lock me in chains, and I break free. Educated, elevated, liberated, clean slated, and set free from passing over opportunities repeatedly. No longer a victim of my society. Freedom of mind during the times of my people is what I strive to see. Wide eyes on the prize, like those who marched with Dr. King. Now, what if Kanye was brilliant but didn't show it? Because what if we was free back then but didn't even know it? What if the biggest lie ever invented gave credit to the white man for the invention of the Christian religion, when in true reality, take it from me, we all would be free if the biased preachers and crooked government leaders actually took time to follow the true teachings of Jesus, put in place not to enslave us, but save us from any unnecessary evils, which still binds us to today. Keeping many who refuse to believe enslaved, like back in the biblical days when the love Jesus showed gave the redeemed hope that ignited their faith. For those with the faith of a mustard seed are bound to be free, according to John 8:36-53. If we do more than just read, for who the Son says free is free indeed. One love. All right. When Israel was in Egypt's land,
let my people go.
Oppressed so hard they could not stand.
Let my people
If we knew, truly knew our history, we wouldn't have time nor the mind to repeat it. Let us go back to the days when we were no longer slaves and our minds were fixed on remaining free. And we were more than determined and moved in faith to be all that we knew we could be. Let us embrace those before us who weathered great storms of many calibers that could only be perceived in our minds. And if ever there was a time to be thankful for their experience without actually experiencing their pain, now is the time. Let us open our hearts to allow gratitude to keep us on the path where many of them only imagined one day they would be, while keeping in mind that the same exact freedom that many of them take, that we take for granted today, is the same freedom they never got to see. And if we are to be moved to our destiny, let us do more than remain free, yet activate our power to fulfill our purpose on God's green earth to be all he has destined us to be. Let it move us to walk in faith, to illuminate and celebrate the great accomplishments and self-defining moments of not just sons and daughters conceived from mothers and fathers born enslaved, but of all those before us and amongst us refusing to allow the horrid events leading to and stemming from slavery to throughout our history to seal their fate. In the same way, we are moved beyond greatness at the thought of them setting the pace by pushing past their pain. Let us live in the light of their love for generations to come, thus refusing to allow their struggles towards freedom to be in vain. Let us allow the same love that propelled the great Carter G. Woodson, alumni of my alma mater, Berea College, to become known as our father of black history, to no longer allow us to perpetuate the mindset of an enslaved people, yet permeate us to fill the shoes of a once oppressed people, rising to the occasion to do more than just walk in their greatness, thus fulfilling our final destiny to be more than just free. And as I look to the sky for my piece of the pie, 40 acres and a mule quickly passes me by. Reparations I have none, yet I chill in the sun, for his word reminds me that he supplies my needs. So from fear I refrain as I call on his name. No, it's never in vain, and it's always the same. With love, power, and a strong mind, I know that in time, if I seek, I will find, and I'll have more than what I search for, more purposeful and divine. For God knows my needs even before I seek, and he's willing to do exceedingly and abundantly above all I ask if I simply believe. If you believe this, then blessed is your faith, and strength you'll receive to stand still and wait as you look up high for your piece of the pie and watch patiently as it falls from the sky. One love. Bye.
Normally we take communion on Sunday morning. We're going to do something different today because we've had some extra things. Let's stand, and we're going to let you do to-go communion, all right? So you can, if you get your wafer ready real quick, we're going to do it, and we're going to go out. Probably didn't sound good, did it? Lord, I hope you know we take it seriously, and we really think this is precious. But we're going to go out singing one of the great songs of this past year. The Lord bless you and keep you, make his face to shine upon you. But if you have your communion, we want to take that as we leave. Could you hand me one down there? the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread. Come on up here, Robert. When he had broke it, he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Take this as often as you do it in remembrance of me." Shall we take the bread?
After the same manner, he took the cup and said, "This is my body, my blood poured out for you. May we all drink."
And now, Lord, we thank you for this day, for every song that's been sung, every poet that's been recited, God, the message that was proclaimed, God, our hearts that were touched. We go out, Lord God, ready, Lord, as the word of God challenged us today, not just to hold to our tightly held beliefs, but let your word, God, melt our hearts, God, and tell us what we're lacking, God, and become everything you want us to be. We love you and we thank you in Jesus' name. And all God's people said amen. Amen. Let's go out singing. The Lord bless you.